Hi, thanks everyone for being here. It's my great pleasure and honor to be here. Right, so my name is Dawn Song. I'm a professor at UC Berkeley and also the founder and CEO of Oasis Labs. And today I'll talk about some new research that we have been doing on a new approach to scaling called Nimble.
Does this work?
And today, as we build applications, we know that data is key. And however, a lot of this data is really sensitive, and handling sensitive data poses a lot of challenges. So first, we need to deal with infrastructure that may not be trusted, may have been compromised, or the applications itself may have vulnerabilities or being compromised as well. And applications may have unintended or undesirable data leakage. So to address all these challenges, we need to develop new technologies. So at Oasis, we have been developing a full stack end-to-end technology to help build a new platform to make it easier to build privacy-first applications. And this platform essentially combines different types of technologies with DGP Ledger, it helps us to essentially record users' rights to data, and also the policies how data can be utilized. And we achieve this through a scalable and verifiable smart contract execution. And also on top of the stack, we use secure computing technologies to enable confidentiality preserving smart contract execution to enable data to be utilized in a secure and a privacy preserving way. And we also enable specific domains for privacy preserving analytics and machine learning. And when we put this all together, as I mentioned, the goal is to build a platform to make it easy to build privacy-first applications that combines the best capabilities from the different domains, including the integrity from distributed ledger, confidentiality from secure computing, and privacy technologies. Earlier, I have in my other talks, I have talked about our privacy technologies, and part of that utilizes secure computing, in particular, for example, utilizing secure hardware. And by combining secure hardware and distributed ledger technology, we can benefit from the integrity from the distributed ledger, which actually doesn't require secure hardware, but also the secure computing from secure hardware that enables confidential smart contracts. So today I want to focus on a different topic, some of the new the research that we have been doing on a new approach to scalability called Nimble. So first, let's look at why the motivation why we need to address this problem. As we look at the evolution of blockchain, going from the original Bitcoin to Ethereum, which mainly enables simple payment transactions, to simple smart contracts, to the later applications, for example, CryptoKitties, which started to have more complex logic. And we can project the future. We would like to run more and more data-rich applications on blockchain. And in particular, as we look at the broader spectrum of different types of applications in blockchain, ranging from financial applications to healthcare to supply chain and many other domains, as we can see, essentially, we need the future blockchains to be able to enable more and more complex data and compute. And as we talk about scalability, another important point that I want to stress is that often times when people talk about scalability, you just hear people talking about transactions per second, and in particular, usually relates to simple payment transactions. However, as the examples that I just mentioned, to really enable the future of blockchains and the broad spectrum of different types of blockchain applications, we really need to enable scalability, not just for simple payment transactions, but actually more for more complex smart contracts. And so that's where our focus is how do we actually achieve scalability for these more complex smart contracts? So let's take a look at why today's blockchain architecture have these scalability challenges. And for example, looking at most of today's blockchain architecture, typically in the blockchain, we need to essentially have enable three key functionalities. Consensus, how different nodes reach agreement, compute, how to execute smart contracts, and storage, how to store the states of these smart contracts. And in most today's blockchain architecture, all these three functionalities are bundled together. Each node needs to do all the three functionalities. And hence, you can see that essentially this bundling creates a bottleneck. And so in today's blockchain architecture, each node needs to essentially do all these functionalities, and each node needs to run on the same computations. So clearly, this can be this can cause a lot of redundancy, a lot of wasted work. There's no parallelism. And poorly written contracts can negatively impact networks for everyone. And as in the case of, for example, with the smart contracts that had more complexity like CryptoKitties, they really caused a lot of congestion in the network. So to address these problems, we need a new approach. And in particular, here we propose a new approach that we call separating execution from consensus. The idea is that essentially, as I mentioned, given that a blockchain needs to accomplish these three key functionalities, consensus, compute, and storage, so instead of bundling the three functionalities together, here we propose a new approach to separate execution from consensus so that we can have different nodes or different layers to handle these different functionalities. So we have different consensus, compute, and storage layer to actually accomplish these different functionalities. So in this case, the consensus layer can agree on the state transitions, and the compute layer execute the transactions. And with this approach, the advantage is for the so when we look at the compute layer, it's very easy for us to increase the compute capacity and the heavy loads. So we can have different compute committees that actually operate on different compute tasks, and this way we can support parallel processing with much greater scalability than other approaches. And also naturally, the different compute committees can actually operate on different types of transactions. So for example, some compute committees can particularly operate on long-running transactions, and some compute committees can even have different types of hardware. For example, some compute committees can have secure hardware so that they can handle confidential smart contracts. And with these layers separate, the consensus layer and compute layers to be separate, then this way, naturally, each layer can scale independently, and each layer can evolve independently as well. And hence, the whole system has a much better modular architecture. However, also, of course, the two layers cannot be completely independent. We need to tie the two together to still ensure the overall integrity and security of the whole blockchain smart contract system. So in this case, the consensus layer performs what we call verifiable computing to verify that the compute layer has done the correct job. It has computed the results correctly, and the final results will then be committed to the consensus layer. And we use different methods for verifiable computing. And one of the new techniques we propose that also helps achieve a greater scalability is what we call discrepancy detection, that I'll talk about in a second. And this new approach with discrepancy detection can provide the same level of integrity and security guarantees with much less redundancy than the traditional the BFT approach. And the consensus layer then verify the state root hash to make sure that to finalize the state transitions. And to put it all together, so essentially we have the consensus, we have the compute layer that executes the transactions, and the states, the new states will then be persisted to the storage layer, and then the consensus layer in the end verifies the correctness of the computation results and agrees on the state transitions. And here, let me just briefly talk about the workflow. So with this workflow, users submit the transactions. The transactions are scheduled by the system scheduler, which then the scheduled tasks are allocated to the different compute committees. The compute workers are stateless, so they actually don't need to reach consensus. They just need to do their compute. And they can even proactively execute the transactions. And the failures of the compute have no effect on the state. So this also helps us to achieve much better parallelization and scalability. And also this allows the scheduling and compute to take place concurrently. And as the compute workers finishes its compute tasks, the state changes are persisted to the storage. And also the compute workers will submit these state change the root hash of the state changes to the consensus layer, and the consensus layer, as I mentioned, will perform what we call verifiable compute to check that these to verify that the computation results from the compute committees are correct, and the state root hashes, the new state root hashes, are correct. And once the consensus layer reaches agreement, these computation results and the new state root hashes will then be committed in the consensus layer. And this way also allows us to achieve what we call horizontal scaling, to really achieve the parallelization that's needed for scalability. And this approach enables us to increase the capacity under heavy workloads, and also, as I mentioned, the compute committees can naturally handle different types of transactions. And the one thing I want to quickly talk about is the discrepancy detection technique that I will use to further significantly reduce the redundancy that's needed to achieve the same level of integrity and security. So the idea of discrepancy detection is that within each compute committee that handles a computation task, we assume that we have at least one compute node that's honest. Then by using discrepancy detection, we can detect any misbehavior as long as we have one compute node that is honest. And in this case, we can essentially tolerate F malicious nodes with just F plus one overall nodes. We're assuming that, again, we have at least one honest node. And whereas if you, for example, in a traditional sharding approach, each shard may need to have 2F plus one or 3F plus one nodes, where F is the number of malicious nodes. And using this approach, we can achieve the same level of security and integrity with, again, much less redundant or replicated work. And the figure here illustrates that for the same level of integrity and security, what's the computation, for example, what's the compute committee size that's needed versus the sharding, a traditional sharding approach, the shard size. And here you can see that for the same level of security, the compute committee size can be need to be much, much less, and oftentimes orders of magnitude less. And hence, we can achieve much greater scalability with the same level of integrity and security, but with a much smaller factor of replication work. And discrepancy detection is one of the methods for verifiable computing that we can utilize in our platform. And we can also utilize other techniques that can be very easily plugged into the platform for verifiable computing, including zero-knowledge proofs and interactive proofs and other types of approaches. And overall, this is the Nimble architecture with the workflow, how we can, again, separate execution from consensus to have these different layers, different committees to handle consensus, compute, and storage to achieve greater scalability. And to summarize, there are a number of advantages for this approach to separate execution from consensus. One, as I mentioned, this approach naturally allows for smaller compute committee sizes to achieve the same level of integrity and security, and hence requires less duplication of work, a great way to achieve greater scalability. And also, with this approach, we can have less latency by avoiding expensive cross-shard calls in common sharding-based approaches. And this modular architecture enables us to, again, for each layer to scale independently and also to evolve independently as well. For example, it's very easy for us to change and adapt to a new type of consensus protocol with this architecture. And this architecture enables a true parallelism that prevents bottlenecking. And it also enables a degree of dynamic scaling that particularly can be well suited for changing workloads. So far I've talked about the new architecture for scalability. And this type of architecture can enable new types of applications. So here, let me give you some example applications that have been building on top of the OASIS platform. So one example is the Kara application. The goal of Kara is to help solve the challenge of data silos in medical data. As we all know that medical data is siloed, it's difficult for medical researchers to gain access to data to help to do medical research as needed. So the goal of Kara is to incentivize doctors and patients to share data and improve medical research. So with Kara, patients can use the technology to help store their data in an encrypted form. And also, the blockchain can help record patients' rights to their data, and also specify the policies for how they want their data to be utilized. And using the secure computing technologies provided by the platform, medical researchers can utilize the data to do data analytics and machine learning in a privacy-preserving way. And also, patients can potentially get rewarded for contributing data as well. And in the whole process, ensuring that their privacy policy is satisfied. So Kara is one type of way to enable data to be utilized in a privacy-preserving way. Also, in one of our recent research projects, we also have been utilizing the scalability and confidentiality capabilities of the platform to enable a new paradigm that we call decentralized federated learning, called HiveMind. By using HiveMind, we essentially have smart contracts, a confidential smart contract that runs on the blockchain platform that actually coordinates distributed federated learning across different end users or different devices, where the raw data is still kept at users' own devices, but this smart contracts on blockchain helps coordinate distributed and this federated learning across users' devices in this decentralized manner, where all the different users and different devices, they can come to train a machine learning model without relying on any central trust. And again, this is only possible because of the scalability and confidentiality capabilities provided by the platform. And this type of technology can enable many other types of applications that really require the scalability to support complex smart contracts and also privacy and confidentiality protection. So we have launched our DevNet 2.0 with new developer experiences and to make it easier for developers to build privacy-first applications. And also, we have done open sourcing certain core parts of the platform. And we have started a bug bounty, and we are on the path to launch our public testnet and with the staking competition towards a phased mainnet rollout. We already have a number of node operators joining our network to actually help run various nodes in the platform. And we look forward to have others to join the network and to run nodes, and also as developers to further develop privacy-first applications on the platform. And in particular, I wanted to share that we'll be starting a staking competition on the Oasis network later in Q4. And we hope more people can join the staking competition to help run nodes, to win rewards, and to help improve the scalability, to improve the stability of the network and the platform. With that, thank you.